know me, this will be redundant. For those of you who don't, my name is Roy Adams. I'm the owner and operator of Chrysler Ironworks. Been that way for almost a decade now, coming up on 10 years of smithing in the trade. I do it full time for a living, and I've been doing that for the past 7 years now, coming up. So it's grown quite a bit. It's went from doing fairly simple stuff, from horseshoe nail hooks and things of that nature, and doing wool hooks and such, to high-end copper work and iron work that I make now. And so it's been quite a wild journey, and I'm blessed to be here. So that's a little bit about my company and what I do. That was a little short introduction. If you want to find out more, you can always go to my YouTube channel. That's a shameless self-promotion plug there. All you have to do is type in Chrysler Ironworks. Mickey Swift over here, he's one of my subscribers. He can tell you how great of a guy I am. He needs some vetting there. I have over 380 some odd videos right now on the subject of blacksmithing, and more being added every day, except with the exception of this weekend, I put out 2 videos a day, 7 days a week, and then that's on top of my 60-hour work. Very heavily involved in blacksmithing. I've been fairly heavily involved in the club. I served as a newsletter editor for 3 years here at the club. And yeah, all around demonstrator, forger, fabricator, you name it. That's me. That's what I do. So I'm blessed to do it. Today we're going to be working with pipe. We're going to start with like the safety precautions of working with pipe. So pipe is essentially a big chimney. It is not a solid bar, so you cannot treat it as a solid piece of stock, okay? So that means a pipe has a side. So if you can picture this as a square instead of a round, a pipe has a side. So whatever material is down in your fire, that is being heated the most. You flip it, this will be the hot spot. You flip it, that'll be the hot spot. You flip it, that'll be the hot spot. And so it's very easy to melt through pipe. Because you're only dealing with the wall thickness. So you, in your mind, you're looking at it, you're like, I've got a 1-inch thick piece of steel here. You do not have a 1-inch thick piece of steel. You have a 16th of an inch or an 8th inch thick piece of steel that you are working with the fire, and that heats fairly quickly. So one of the first things you do when working with pipe in the forge when you're heating it, you're turning it. Just like roasting a hot dog or marshmallow. Marshmallow is a better example of hot dogs. Never mind that. Anyways, so you want to take and roll this around like a rotisserie when it's in the fire. Now, I made up all these are the lips we're going to be working with today, so we're going to be using tongs to hold these. Did that for 2 points. As I said, pipe is a chimney. Just takes whatever is needed in here and exhausts it out the other end. So one way of combating that is to take it wet at the end of the newspaper, ball it up, and shove it in at the end of the pipe. This air in here will still heat up being in the forge. So this will still get uncomfortably hot, and it can go from uncomfortably hot to flesh-burning pain pretty quick. You know, walk away from it, go do something, come back to it, and you touch it, it's hot. So those are some considerations to worry about when you're investing in pipe. So that's where the tongs come in. We're going to be using tongs today because the tongs don't transfer the heat as quickly as the pipe does. So you can stick the piece in the fire, you can roll it around, get it hot, grab onto the piece again, bring it out, no chance of burns. Of these digits. Speaking of burns, this is what happens when you get in a rush with blacksmithing. So I've been doing it for a long time and I still get burnt. This is about as severely as I've been burnt this year. This, this, and this was all in one day. And it was all based upon my own stupidity in the shop. No excuses for it, just my own stupidity. I was forged and welding with billet in Damascus. I was on a tight timeline to get my beam hammer plans out, done, video shot, trailer, live stream, had everything going. I had customer orders, I had to get out the door. And so usually I would knock off, take a moment, just knock off the flux that would be on the billet before I go under a power hammer and forge weld it. Did not do that. So that is liquid hot flux that jumped up. It went down my glove, how precious my glove is. And it started there, and it was burning and trickling, and actually you can see this on the video, because the video, there's a pause where the billet's sitting there. That's me cussing and not being very Christian like that here off camera and then coming back and going back to work. I didn't observe how bad it was until I looked at it, and essentially I rolled that molten flux just right down my hand here. And that is still healing up, still painful. So do not rush. Don't feel like you're getting in a rush. I said all that to make a point. In classes like this, it's a tendency to look how somebody else is doing and judge your own progression. Don't do that. Don't do that. Learn the process, not the project today. Because it's the process that you can take to your own home forges. It's the process that you can take on with you for years and years and years to come and apply it to multiple different projects. So learn the process. You don't listen to anything else I say today. Make that a credo for yourself anytime you take a class. Of listening to the instructor, learning the process well, and don't focus on where you're at in the grand scheme of things while you're moving along. Because everybody will progress, I guarantee, at their own pace and at different rates of speed. So don't get in a rush. Rush causes safety accidents to happen. So, well, not safety accidents, I don't know how you say that. The proper vernacular there. Let's see here. One of the other things that we won't do with pipe. I have to do a lot of safety here. I'm going to sound like a safety nut, safety Nazi, and that's fine, because that's who I am. And it's what allowed me to keep all my fingers, digits, and toes, and keep this pretty face looking good for camera.
You're a star.
Allows me to keep a beard, you know, things like that. One thing we never do with pipe, you never, ever, 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 if you want to get yelled at by your instructor, let me catch you dipping this pipe in water today. I will scold you and make you feel bad about yourself, guaranteed. Reason for that being, once again, going back to a chimney effect. You stick this blazing hot piece of pipe down in the water, it creates high pressure steam, it shoots right up that nozzle, and it burns you bigger than the sun. You think that's bad, have a bunch of high pressure steam go up like this across you. If you burn from here to here, you're lucky. Yeah. You know, don't land on you, burn you elsewhere. Okay, so never quench the pipe. Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Now stop. Now shut up. Any questions? Who's going to get yelled at today? Any questions?
No? No?
Very good? Okay. So as you can see, this hasn't even had airflow in it. And look how that bottom side is already heated up quite a bit. That's what I'm talking about. You're not working it. Mentally, it feels like a large piece of stock. It is not. So when you're working with your pipe on the fire, you want to make sure that you don't have your pipe sticking up like this. Once again, going back to the chimney effect, hot air likes to rise up. So if you stick it down in the fire like so, what you'll end up happening is it'll take all those cinders that are in the fire, start shooting them back up at you, like this. You guys might experience that today. If you're having that problem, it's because you need to angle your pipe down so it comes into the fire like so. So it's setting on top of the fire, and you're rotating it and getting it hot. That makes sense. If it's horizontally in the fire, you won't have a problem. If it's like this in the fire, going towards the bottom, going to shoot sparks and embers back up at you, and those cause burns.
Now you guys are going to work with the gas forges. Those tend to heat up the entire length of pipe. Your coal is pretty localized, so if it gets way hot, let it air cool. Don't quench it.
Yeah, don't quench it. So now, you'll see me on on some of my videos occasionally, if you become a subscriber of my channel, you'll see me work with pipe. And when I work with pipe, it'll look like a cool ball pipe. And the only time that you do that is you do that from the outside of the pipe. So that is with a dipper can, and it is with the pipe in a horizontal position, and you run the water and rotate the pipe, and it cools off that section of pipe. But you never plunge pipe. Not unless you want to learn about steam real quick.
Steam bad.
Pretty much. Unless you're a boiler. Or pressure cooker. Unless you're one of those two items, I want you to see yourself. So the first step. So the first stage in this process, we have got to segregate off our pipe. So we're going to use our guillotine tools to start right off, okay? So we need to isolate this section of pipe, this material. Now, for this, it's just coming in about an inch and a quarter in from each end of this piece, and it starts segregating the pipe there, okay? After which, we will square this cross section and we will put in this twist. So, come in about an inch and a quarter in from the ends, okay? That measurement's completely trivial. Just come in equally for both ends, okay? You need a minimum of about an inch because when the rim's rolled out, it's a whole bottom of the candlestick. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So come in at least an inch. So inch, make a fuller mark. Behind that inch line, so on and so forth on the back on the other side.
Or we kind of like this then.
This pipe here, this is just standard iron pipe. This is what they call, this is schedule B pipe. It's like a black iron pipe.
Yes.
So like now, gas pipe is schedule 40. Like what you get from Home Depot, and that's a thinner wall pipe. Schedule A is a lot thicker wall. You guys
have don't use galvanized pipe.
Do not use galvanized.
Yeah.
Unless you have done some sort of acid bath or soak with it or put in a large campfire outdoors and you were not grilling marshmallows over or hot dogs while it burnt off one of those.
The acid treatment's what I've heard, you know,
does the best. Put in acid soap. Yeah, this is just schedule 8 pipe.
So you can do this with black iron from the store, schedule 40.
Schedule 40 pipe with a thinner wall, you have to be a little more genteel with. It does not like to take the forging as well, because there's not as thick of a weld seam on there, and so you can have a problem with the weld seam splitting when you're forging on it. So the first thing that you want to do when you're using a guillotine tool is you need to remember that this is 8-inch wall pipe. It's very thin. Require a lot of heavy hammering, okay? So you want to take very nice light blows until you get a groove started, okay? It's more important to get that groove square to the pipe's cross-section, okay, than it is to get all the work done in a moment of time. So you do not have to get this done on heat. We're going to take really light hammering blows. This is what we're essentially around there. We want to take it light around the first time, heat it back up, take it light around the second time, and heat it back up. And once you've got a good groove established, then you can start hitting harder and harder hammer blows. Okay? You want to work the pipe in a sort of very hot. This is a class, so this isn't down and sort of collapse it completely and maintain the point that it'll fall off. We're not going that far. We're only going, what I would say, it's about a third. If you look on the inside diameter, you can see in there. Not
2 feet.
Yeah, you put a little box in it, not a bunch of pipe or whatever. So just a little bit of water, yeah. So we're wanting to go from this here to this here. Okay, so you can see kind of the size reduction there. You don't want to beat this too thin. The reason why is because we're going to rely on these to be able to twist the center section. Okay, so if you beat this too thin, and I'll be around. Go too thin here, that'll want to twist on us before center section. The reason why we have to isolate this section that we're going to be twisting is because of the whole pipe. Say you squared up the whole pipe, well, that's not good. So you just want the square section, right? You want that in the ground. Can't square up the pipe. It's very hard to square just the center section of the pipe if there's no segregation to it. If you don't segregate off that little center section there, when you're trying to square it off, the whole pipe wants to square off.
Speaking of that, if you work with a cut section like we are, would you want a fuller in the other end before you start squaring the middle?
Yes, both ends have got to be fuller. It has to be segregated on. So we'll be using this predominantly for the first half of the morning, so to speak.
You're going to make both ends equal?
Equal would be preferred. You don't have to, but both ends equal is what's preferred.
So we're going to turn that little bit 5 or 6 inch intersection. We're going to make it square. When you say square, we're going to make it square.
Yep, we're going to end up squaring it up. Yep, and then it'll actually get a chisel groove cut in it. We'll get to that when we get to that stage because there's a reason why you have to chisel groove. The reason why you have to chisel groove this is because the pipe won't collapse right to create a twist. So if you just squared it, and we may even do this, I'll take and do it on this just so you can see the difference. But if you just square this and were to twist it, it would just kink. It would just kink. It wouldn't collapse into a twist.
So those
4 planes, or the 2 planes that you're working with, when you go to twist them, those planes will just kink. They're just almost like you're bringing on something, they will just kink over, flop over. If you put the grooves in there, you control where that kink is happening now. So it follows the grooves. And that's what allows it to twist. Alright, so everybody can. As long as you all have your safety glasses on, you can get as close as you like. We're going to get this hot. You see me turn in the pipe here. Ideally, if you're going to be beginning at something, I would love for people to use long pieces like this. But with the safety concerns of pipe, and I had anticipated there was a couple guys that called me and said they had no forging experience whatsoever, never done it before. And so in anticipation of that, and I mean, the general audience, maybe people who've never worked with pipe before, it's just a dangerous thing. You get used to working with solid steel. And, just dangerous. So decided that this was a much safer route to go to do tongs. I don't know, we got any tong clips around here, but I can make some up if I need to in class. Help say what there is. Okay, get this underneath here. It's important to find your grooves again. Slide it in. Get it. If you notice, I'm going a little harder to hit this now. sucks that's about 4 feet height is the fact that you gotta be so genteel with it. But you know what's the great thing about forging pipe? You see me sweating up a storm, you see me like really laboring, and I don't know, I'm not. It's a very smooth and easy process. So there, we've got to be very cool and easier. So now we can start getting a little harder. Because as we compress this in this groove, it's thickening. It's thickening this wall section. It's not thinning. It's thickening. It's essentially we're upsetting this on itself.
Okay. That's what you're doing.
You're decreasing the circumference, but it's not growing the limb. Okay. So you're technically upsetting this piece.
That's what I'm
saying. But in a circle, that's what we're doing. This is starting to oval a little bit here. That's because I've done more hammering on this plane than I've done in this plane. So more in this way, less in this way. So what we're going to do is bring that next time I bring it out. We'll look, oh, there's the oval. We're going to set that up. I'm going to start to hammer a little there. Now we'll wrap that up. Any questions? Ever want to take another class with me ever again, is I am information saturation. That's what I'm into. So, you know, I try to squeeze as much knowledge as I possibly can to equip you with the abilities to go your own home forge, and you know what you're doing. You know, that is my goal. say you decide you want that a little deeper. After you put in the twist, you can always come back and deepen those. But we have to leave it thick right now. We don't leave it thick. When you go to twist this center section, it's going to want to collapse here. Twist. Okay? All right. Well, that's it for the demonstration of the first part of this process. Scale. In this, you'll feel the need. Some people like to brush scale a lot. I'm going to give you guys this little secret. I get asked all the time, how do you get such a clean finish right off the anvil? And it comes from the correct heat. Most people brush at the incorrect heat. So I'm going to show you what that looks like real quick, and then you guys, I'm going to turn you loose on the forges with your pipes. And then I'll have a lot of walking to do today, huh?
Yep.
Keep up there, buddy. And if anybody has any questions, do not hesitate to ask. I'm busy with somebody specifically. You know, just give me a moment and, you know, just say, hey, when you get a minute, something, and I will do my best to get around to everybody as much as I can. Remember, I'm one guy, there are eight people. One guy, eight people. I'm good, not that way.
What's the bottom?
That's lead. So that was made not originally for a candle. Now, obviously we can do a candle in it, but that was originally made for a little flower sculpture that sat down in there and made it look like flowers growing out of it, and a fairly lightweight flower. Obviously, you can see that's a little tall to just have a flaming hot object up here that if somebody bumps the table could flop over and burn the house down. So we're going to do it a little bit different from this design here. So we are going to make not only are we going to make the base portion of it, but we're going to make the base that that connects to. So this way it's got a good solid base. This will be textured. Sure you guys have a picture. Yep. And then these just get welded on, but there's a little secret to it. This little bit will go in here, get welded, and then insert it through a whole foot holder from underneath. So this way you don't see a nasty weld around the top side. Because welds being shown are heavy in a blacksmith shop. Yes, sir.
I noticed this chimney has such a great draft. Just a natural draft, or is there a fan up there?
It's a natural draft.
There's sand blowing up here.
There's nothing up there pulling.
No, there's nothing that pulls us. This is all just natural draft.
Yeah. On your forges, you want this square inches. There's a smoke shelf in there. That square inches, and your pipe square inches, to be all the same. If they're different, you've got a restriction. It's too bad. This square inch, the smoke shelf square inch, and your pipe diameter, rabbit, all got to be the same square inches. All these,
essentially, it creates a vacuum effect.
You're talking about adding, you know, like when you've got a circular pipe, the slice off, you can measure the radius, you find the area.
Yeah.
Okay, so sure. The area of the hole opening?
Area, yes. Yeah, that holds up. Smoke shelf, there's a smoke shelf in here, the slice.
Yeah, I know a smoke shelf.
So in simple non-math terms, simple non-math terms, this here is the same free area as the tube that's going through the roof, but in here there's a bigger volume inside here. So when that pulls, it creates a vacuum which pulls. Does that make sense? When the air outside drafts, when it drafts, it pulls a bigger, greater vacuum in here. Creates a negative space. This is obviously a positive pressure space, and it pulls it in there.
The colder it is outside, the better the draft.
Not really. The draft's not. The draft is affected a little bit by heat and cool, but that's mainly just because, say, outside is cold, you're going to have a lot lower pressure, so to speak. Inside's, you know, hot, we're going to have a higher pressure. So a higher pressure is going to always want to see the lower pressure. That makes sense. That's why that curve a great number of years. Well, not a great number, but enough. I did that for off and on, total of 8 years, and about six of those full pine. So, we won't get into Roy's former glories. We'll just stick with the present ones. All right. I like making statements like that. This is seeing if you make things up. So, this right here is a scaling peak. If you brush this, the only thing it's going to do, if you come up close, you'll see, it's just going to produce more scales. It just produces more scales. It should, you clean off the leather, look, you see how it faded almost back? There's more scale back there. So it's hot. Anything above that temperature range, okay, it's a scaling peak. So a bright orange to like a yellow or a white or any of that forging temperature that you see there, oxidize. At this heat now, it is not in the oxidization stage. So now if you brush it, that scale does not form back. See that sheen? And get on the pipe? Yeah, you let it cool off to a bright red, okay? And you can brush this all the way down into a black heat. And you can produce a very fine looking finish on forged steel just straight off the anvil. I mean, that compared to that.
What kind of finish they put on that black pipe? What do you mean? Is that made?
That's a varnish. It's a little oxidized
stud. The stuff from the store, like the flat iron, it's got like a varnish on it, almost like a paint of some sort.
Oh, yeah.
It burns right off. Don't want to breathe it. I'm pretty sure it's not good for you to do, but yeah, it's, you see how shiny that is now. That wasn't hooked to any mechanical equipment. You know, that's how it's done. You see guys all the time brushing, because it's completely pointless to brush scale all a piece at a really high heat. The only time that you'll see me do that is if I had something stuck from the fire to the piece that I didn't want to beat and impregnate into the surface, I'll give it a quick brush to just knock that out. Most of the time, I don't even brush. If I got something stuck to it, you'll be able to see it come out, I'll do this. Good time. It's quicker, don't have to brush, waste the bristles. Brush at the lower heats to try to achieve the higher reaches. I added enough value today. Okay. Going home. You guys got this, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, let's get started. So, everybody grab a piece of pipe. There's one for everybody. And you need to take and find yourself a pair of tongs back there on that table that will hold the pipe right there. Firmly. Watch. These were cut off on an abrasive saw, so there may be some sharp edges. Be careful of that. So we're going to start with the pipe first. We'll get to the pieces later. I don't know if we have enough for everyone, but... all good, man. It'll be hot for a while.
Oh, yeah. That's like the third time I've dropped.
Oh, yeah. Like you know what you're doing.
I have no clue what I'm doing.
Pressure's on.
The top.